During the summer of 2014, I was lucky enough to travel to Southeast Asia. I was so excited during the weeks leading up to my departure, and I spent a lot of my free time researching the places I would visit, the things I would do, the food I would eat. I spent hours watching travel videos about street food in Hanoi, the temples of Angkor in Cambodia. My head was completely wrapped up in thinking about my adventure. At the behest of my father, though, and since I was planning to travel to rural areas, malaria endemic areas, I made sure to get a consultation with a travel doctor. I got a big bottle of malaria medication, I sprayed all my clothes with permethrin, I bought the insect repellent my doctor recommended, I even bought international SOS coverage in case of an emergency. I was prepared, but really I was focused on everything else about my trip. All in all, health risks weren't a big concern of mine, and my preparation meant that I just felt a little more confident and secure as I left for my first solo backpacking trip. I had no definite route or plan, but I knew the places I wanted to see and roughly how I would get there. Southeast Asia is easily navigable by land or by air, and the countries are relatively small. For these reasons, the region attracts a lot of backpackers. So I flew into Bangkok on July 30th and spent the beginning of my trip there. In fact, I spent most of my trip there, actually about 10 days longer than I had planned. Doesn't sound like the worst thing ever, right? An extra week and a half in Thailand on vacation? Well, first, let me tell you why that happened. Almost 2 weeks into my trip, and I was headed to Thailand's eastern coast to visit a few of the popular islands. I met backpackers from all over the world, I learned to scuba dive, I tried tons of interesting food, got a little bit immersed into Thai culture, I even met my English friend Alex, who invited me to travel with him to Nepal to hike the Himalayas. My parents went to Nepal 30 years ago when they got married, and the stories they've always told me made the opportunity to go myself too incredible to turn down. I bought a round-trip ticket to Kathmandu, and I pretty quickly changed my plans to spend the second half of my trip in Nepal. On one of our last nights in Thailand, Alex and I were having dinner at a restaurant when I started feeling nauseous and faint. I had hardly even tasted my soup when I passed out cold at the table. When I came to, I think I asked Alex how long I had been out, and he told me it was only a few seconds, but I had managed to throw up, regurgitate, the little bit I had eaten all over the table. I was nauseous, dizzy, my head ached. And on top of all of this, I was in a foreign country by myself. I didn't know it yet, but this was the very beginning of my dreadful 10-day experience with dengue fever. Needless to say, I missed that flight to Kathmandu, and the 10 days following my little episode at dinner were some of the most physically painful and uncomfortable of my life. I didn't know the illness I'd been feeling on the island was dengue fever until I made it back to Bangkok, so the incessant headaches and fatigue I experienced in the first few days were not only really uncomfortable, but also confusing. Things got really bad on my way back to Bangkok. Once I actually got from the island to the train on the mainland, which would take me back to Bangkok, it was running over 45 minutes late. I remember curling up in the fetal position on the platform with my bags and guitar strapped to my front and back. People were looking at me, but I was completely debilitated by my fatigue and weakness. On top of that, I had a constant headache I'd been having for the past 2 days, and my body shivered with chills. All I could do to comfort myself was lie on the platform with my eyes closed and try not to fall asleep for fear of missing the train. Once I made it to Bangkok, I was actually diagnosed with dengue fever. I spent the following 7 of those 10 days between my hotel room and the hospital, and otherwise had no energy or motivation to do anything but lie still in my bed. The chills and headache went away, but my body ached severely. I was constantly exhausted, and I couldn't eat more than a bite or two of anything that was put in front of me. I counted the hours between doses of Tylenol, always taking the maximum, and I had to have my blood taken every other day until my platelet and white blood cell count returned to normal. My doctor even cautioned me against getting bruised in any way because my platelets and white blood cells were so low. I was alone, very far from home, and really sick. Dengue fever is a mosquito-borne disease similar to malaria, but with no available vaccine or medical prevention. It's really common in Thailand, and as I discovered later, it was high season for dengue when I was there. Because of what the virus does to your body and blood cells, a small number of the some 50 million cases worldwide result in hemorrhagic fever and possible death. This number is small, but it is real. I, like most, made a full recovery from dengue, though the 10 or so days I had it were miserably painful and costly in terms of medical bills. I also missed my flight to Nepal and the opportunity of a lifetime to hike through the Himalayas. During those days on the islands where I was bitten by a mosquito carrying the dengue virus, I'll admit I wasn't being consistent with my use of insect repellent, which was supposed to be used alongside malaria medication to prevent me from getting sick. The irony of my story is that because malaria is a more widely known disease, and because there's medicine to prevent it, I was less knowledgeable of and prepared for dengue, for which there is no available vaccine. Since the malaria map my travel doctor gave me didn't show much or any risk of infection on the islands I was visiting, I comfortably stopped using my insect repellent and taking my malaria medication. Dengue was the last thing on my mind when I traveled to Southeast Asia, but it's one of the first things that comes to mind when I think back on my trip. I knew basically nothing about dengue when I left, but came back with a base of knowledge and awareness of this disease, which is a real threat to travelers and those working abroad in endemic regions. This awareness is what I want to share with people. Take the time to learn more about dengue and the support you have to prevent it, whether you're on vacation backpacking or working abroad in endemic areas. There are effective measures to take against dengue, and one of the most important ones, something you can do personally, is using insect repellent appropriately and consistently. Not doing so was my mistake. Don't let it be yours. Protect yourself from dengue fever.